Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
And now, right now, it's the best of Bob and Sheri.
You guys have the best show on radio.
Thank you.
Listen and decide in your own mind what sounds best.
Five personality traits that make you live longer. Are you interested?
I'm so interested.
All right. Well, you better be conscientious. Meaning you think things through before you jump out there and take an unnecessary risk.
I got that.
You have that one? I think you do.
I do.
I think you do. Openness.
I got
meaning
that.
Meaning you're... Can I finish for a second, please?
I'm open to hearing the rest of it.
Oh, you got it all. Why don't you... Yeah. Let me just say you've got them all. That's all we care about. That's all we
I
care
think
about.
It's funny. You're open, but not open to hearing what the explanation
is. I'll hear what the rest of it is.
I know. Thank you for noticing that, by the way.
I got it, but I'll hear.
Openness, meaning you'll take every man that comes your way. No, I'm only kidding. That's not what it says. Meaning you're receptive to new concepts and experiences. In other words, you keep learning and you don't resist change too much. That is, yeah, that is definitely you. Let me see. Is that me? Receptive to new concepts.
No. Don't resist change.
And experiences.
No.
So. Do I want you to what?
Do you want me to vote on whether it's you or not?
Yeah, I want someone who I know will be voting negatively toward me. You're not tricking me. You're not tricking
me. Finally catching on to that.
Yeah. Emotional stability. Hush. People who freak out and get depressed about everything do not tend to live as long. If you can figure out how to roll with the punches, you'll live longer. I don't think I'm going to be here tomorrow. You know, that's one that I've always wanted to be more laid back, you know, more like Matthew McConaughey.
But here's what's interesting. You want to be that. But
my wife is listening. She's saying, I'd like that, too.
You want to be that, but you seem to think that you don't have to actually make the effort to get there, that this is something that can just happen for you. You have to try.
I think it's always down the road I'm going to get to this destination.
No.
But meanwhile, I'm on the, you know, highway uptight. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you that's future living. It's crazy.
Yeah, I know. I got to learn to roll with the punches. Friendliness. It goes hand in hand with being positive. Plus, people who socialize and stay close with friends tend to live longer. I'm friendly. I'm a friendly person, don't you think?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm not overly friendly. You know, I'm not friendly to the point where everyone is my friend, which I think is ridiculous.
You're slow to make friends.
I am a little slow to make friends. But then when I have friends, I'm very loyal. Yes, Bob, you are.
Yes, Bob, you are.
Okay. Just don't leave me hanging.
Yes, Bob,
every segment has got to have a conclusion, okay? And finally, expressing yourself freely. I got that.
Oh, yeah.
I got that one. Yeah, I knew. I get an amen from the church members on that one.
I feel pretty good about this.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
You've got all of this. I've got about half. People who bottle stuff up do not tend to live as long as folks who can express their feelings. So be conscientious, be open, emotional stability, friendliness, and expressing yourself freely. That is very, very true. I think people who don't express themselves, like something is bugging them, somebody is tormenting them, and they bottle it up, man, that'll put you in the dirt fast.
There's a lot to be said for being open to new experiences. Because if you're open to new experiences, then you're open to new friendships and you're open to learning things and you're open to the possibility that even if things aren't awesome right now, they could be. You know, it's taking some responsibility for it.
You, Sheri Lynch, do that more than anybody I know.
Yeah, that's true. I think there's something to be said for doing the same things over and over, though. I'm serious about that.
You get good at them. Yeah, practice.
I know what's there. I know that, you know, if I go to a certain place for vacation, I like this certain restaurant, right? I'm going to enjoy being there. Oh, here we are again. We're over at the restaurant again. Oh, there's that view. Oh, here's the mountain. You know, I like the comfort of that.
That's comforting, but to me, that can be really bittersweet because what calls you to that place or that experience is something unique to an event in the past. And then you go back there and it doesn't live up. You can't recreate that moment. And then you've got that bittersweet nostalgia feeling.
No, I don't find that I get that. I find that I enjoy living in the past sometimes.
I mean, of course you want to go back to places that you've loved and had a great time, but yeah. There's so many new things. Like, you could never live long enough to experience everything that's out there.
Well, I mean, I traveled a lot when I was, you know, in television and all. I mean, I've seen a lot of new things. Now I just want to be here with you every day.
Hashtag lucky girl. Hashtag lottery. Hashtag
damn
winning.
Damn straight. Have a wonderful day for yourself today, ladies and gentlemen.
Winning.
Yep.
You're listening to the best of Bob and Sheri.
Absolutely.
Congratulations, Sheri Lynch, named one of the most influential women in radio again this year. It's Bob and Sheri.
Peyton, welcome to the show.
Hey, Peyton.
Hi, everybody. I'm calling for an apology from Bob.
Uh-oh. He's good at it.
I'm good at it, baby.
Limbers up. What does he need to apologize to you for, Peyton?
I have a lot of friends who listen to Bob and Sheri, and a couple months ago, you had a show about celibacy. Mm-hmm. And a friend called me bright and early saying, you're a virgin, you need to call in. So I did, and I was like, surely not. There's no laughs in celibacy. There's no way they could be doing a show on celibacy. I live that life. And then I do call in, and then other friends, even though I use a code name, are like, wait, you're a virgin? So you added me as a virgin, and I think you should apologize.
So you did use a code name, Peyton, but your friends recognized your voice.
Yeah.
They do. Well,
you have a distinctive voice. It's very smoky.
People never think voices are distinctive, but they are.
I know.
Are you still a virgin, Peyton? And don't you dare apologize for that or feel embarrassed about that.
The last 2 months, I'm still a virgin. I'm sorry. It was very traumatizing. And to the virgin community, I think that, you know, we should be apologized.
I'm confused. The last 2 months?
Well, since he was out, I'm still a virgin.
Peyton is looking for two things here, Bob. He wants a personal apology, and then he wants you to apologize to the virgin community, which, granted, is a small population, but nonetheless deserving of respect.
Yeah, that won't take long. My apologies to the virgin community and to you, Peyton. And I just heard that there is a new book out written by a woman who all of a sudden decided to be celibate, and she has stayed celibate for like...
A week?
No. 12 years or 14 years or something like that. And she said, it improved my life so much because it made things a lot easier. There was no pressure to have to conform to anyone's needs. And she said, I started traveling more. I started reading more. I slept better. I had fewer worries once I became celibate. Now, I'm not saying it's for everybody, but you're agreeing with that.
No, that's just our excuse, but I'm just kidding about all that. I did you a favor for you, Bob, because I love you so much, and I created you a list. I have for you now the list of the top 10 things that Bob Lacey, cannot actually say.
Okay, that I
cannot say, but you're going to say for me.
Yes, I'm going to say
all right,
for you.
All right,
Bring it on.
I
think of this as a public service announcement. Sheri, I need your buy-in. And Max, I need a bell, and I need a gong at the end. And Todd, where the hell is the sun?
I am dying.
I'm in.
All right?
I'm in.
All right. Now, and the number one thing. All right, we're going to go from 10 to 1.
Okay.
So, number 10. I don't care if you're a first-time caller. Thank you, Sheri. That's good. Number 9. To be honest, I do think I'm better than you. Number 8. I don't know what Soundhound actually is. Number 7. What kind of grown man calls a radio show to tell another grown man he's calling for the first time so the other one snaps his fingers? Who do they think I am, at One Trick Pony? Okay, number 6. Deep down, I do believe my hair can be trained. These are things that Bob Lacey cannot actually say, but I am for.
Hurry!
Number 4. I actually like that Sheri has a book of Bob. It's probably worth a lot of money since it's after me, after all. Number 3. No one can hijack a story but me. Number 2. I do less show prep than my listeners. Number 1. Panties.
Never allow Peyton. Never allow ever. Peyton on the show again.
I love you guys. You're great.
Thanks, Peyton.
I'm bringing in Peyton to co-host the next time you're out sick. Yeah. Great job, Peyton.
You're listening to the best of Bob and Sheri.
Absolutely.
We've got him.
Morons.
With Bob and Sheri.
He's a moron.
It's Morons in the News.
Okay, our first moron in the news comes out of South Plimpton, Australia. The police were called to a report of a prowler at a building site. And when they arrived, they cordoned off the area and they brought in a canine patrol. Very exciting. After initially finding nothing, the police noticed something kind of strange. There was a statue outside of the building that seemed to be just out of place. Further investigation found that the statue seemed to be breathing. The guy had hidden in plain sight by pretending to be a statue.
So good. So good.
Well, it worked for a little bit.
It did. It did. I mean, the dogs didn't figure it out. So he was charged with criminal trespass.
I love this guy. You know what? He said to himself, what are my choices? Using a bicycle as a getaway vehicle or pretending to be a statue? I like what he went with. Yeah. Today's moron of the day is a woman who boarded a bus in Brazil bound for Rio, pregnant, but it turned out that she wasn't really going to Rio to have her baby, and she wasn't even pregnant. Her belly turned out to be a watermelon, which she cut in half, hollowed out, and filled with four brick-sized portions of cocaine paste.
Wow.
The drugs weighed more than 4 pounds. They were seized by police. The police had gotten a tip that there was a drug mule aboard the bus. She confessed that she had received the drugs in Paraguay and was planning on taking them to Rio. She was taken to a police station after being arrested by a motorcycle squad. That must have been an exciting day. It was described by military police as creativity without limit. And they showed pictures. They took pictures and showed the watermelon disguise along with pictures of the cocaine bricks.
You know, I bet that would have worked if there was not a tip that there was a drug mule on that plane. Because I'm just thinking, if you cut a watermelon, a good-sized watermelon in half, that could kind of look like the belly of a pregnant woman.
Underneath her t-shirt, it absolutely did. Yeah,
is that right?
It absolutely did.
It's actually kind of clever. Our next one comes from Goose Creek, South Carolina, where the local neighborhood group have been fielding complaints about a porch pirate, a guy stealing, of course, packages from residents. They had a video of the guy in action, which they posted on their neighborhood Facebook page. Well, the Goose Creek Police, and I just love that phrase, the Goose Creek Police. I'd like to see one of their cars. They also followed that page, and they noted that the porch pirate was wearing a very distinctive bright green t-shirt. Every time he did a hustle, he was wearing this bright green t-shirt. For some reason, known only to him, he was wanted on a court date for something else that he had done, and he showed up in the courtroom with the police with a green t-shirt, the same one. After a quick confirmation, it was the guy in the video, and he was arrested. Had he not worn that for probably a parking violation or something like that, he would not have been busted. And that is Morons in the News.
Who wants to go to jail just because they were too lazy to do laundry? You know?
Tell me about
it. We all have a favorite shirt, you know.
What a thing. It is Bob and Sheri.
Instant access to the podcast, and fun side. Just download the free Bob and Sheri app.
I went to such a great wedding this summer. It was so much fun. And there was not one person there who could ruin this wedding. Well, I mean, except for the end of the night when somebody got a DUI. But that generally happens in my family at a wedding. I mean, you haven't really done your job as somebody with an open bar if somebody's uncle doesn't get a DUI. That's how the Lynches operate. But I found this list that made me laugh out loud of the 7 people that will absolutely ruin your wedding.
Mm-hmm.
The first one is the texter. This is the person who doesn't turn their phone off and it goes off in the middle of your vows.
Yeah, I can see how today that would be a problem.
And somebody, I don't know who did this or why, it was probably like The Knot or one of these wedding sites. They did a survey and they found that people are more likely to turn their phone off in a movie theater.
than
nobody
at a wedding.
Nobody thinks to turn it off at a wedding.
Mm-hmm.
And so not only are people taking ugly pictures of you at unflattering angles and mm-hmm. then posting them on Instagram,
mm-hmm.
where you've just hired an expensive photographer to make you look amazing. Now there's a picture of you cross-eyed with your tongue hanging out on Instagram and all your friends are commenting on it. People are not only doing that, they're texting and taking calls.
It's so rude.
In church during the service.
It's so rude. I guess whose job is it? The minister to say before the ceremony begins, please put away your phones or turn off your phones?
This wedding group said you can do it three ways. You can put a note in the program about silencing your phones.
Right.
You can have every usher, as the usher seats you, have the ushers tell you to turn your phones off, or you can have the minister. And nothing kicks off a ceremony of commitment and eternal true love like a minister telling everyone to turn their phones off.
I know. He's wagging his finger at you, right? It's a bummer, isn't it?
But better that than actually having it go off.
Yeah. The second person that will ruin your wedding is the problem bridesmaid. Have we all met the problem bridesmaid? Have we perhaps been the problem bridesmaid?
I don't know what that person does. What does that person do?
The problem bridesmaid does not like the dress that you've chosen, is not pleased about how expensive this wedding has turned out to be, and is maybe a little bit jealous that you're getting married first.
As far as the expense goes, you mean how much money she had to put into it with travel, the hotel, the dress.
And parties and everything.
Yeah.
The problem bridesmaid, followed by the difficult future mother-in-law. Now, many of us have lovely mothers-in-law, but some of us have a mother-in-law who wants to be too involved.
Mm-hmm.
My niece, Brittany, I should get her on the phone. She does the greatest impersonation of her mother-in-law. Her mother-in-law, no matter what Brittany does, her mother-in-law says the following sentence to her, Brittany, and then fill in the blank, Brittany. Why are you holding the baby like that? Brittany, everything is Brittany. Brittany, why you make the wedding in New Jersey? Brittany.
She's going to be doing that impersonation for the next 25 years.
When she starts into it, we all just slide onto the floor laughing. It's so funny. The guest with a guest. You know, the person that did not get a plus one invitation but showed up with one anyway?
Anyway, yeah.
And this only happens at weddings where you're paying for sit-down dinners.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder
if people who are caterers know that there's going to be at least one of those.
To have some
and maybe
extra
as
food.
Many as three or four to have extra food.
They say that when you do your catering, you should budget in extra food.
Mm-hmm.
I've noticed that anytime you have like a beach barbecue wedding, seven people say that they're coming and don't show up.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have a sit-down dinner,
mm-hmm.
seven extra people that you've never seen before roll in.
You know what is really interesting, and I think because I am one of these people, a little unfair, that the tradition of the father of the bride paying for everything has continued. Now, it used to be like, you know, in ancient times, all right, the father of the bride, you're taking on the expense of my daughter.
Yeah.
But you know what? That's a long time ago. And I ain't getting no sheep. You know what I'm saying, Beck? I'm not going to be getting some gold.
His lordship will not receive the river bottom lands.
Yeah, exactly.
Let me tell you
need to change this.
Let me tell you what his lordship will receive. And that's a good ass kicking.
That's exactly right.
That's what you will be receiving.
Actually, I would take the ass kicking. What I don't
at least
want
you got something
is,
to show
is
for
the
it.
Debit card being put into use.
The open bar abuser. This person will ruin your wedding.
Oh, yeah.
Not just because they're running up your tab, but because they're going to get disruptively drunk. And this is going to take the form of a couple of things. A long sloppy toast, an unbelievable display on the dance floor.
Right.
An aggressive bout in the parking lot, a DUI. Yep. At this wedding I attended recently, we did have the uncle with a DUI, but that's a Lynch family tradition, and that's as much a part of it as throwing the bouquet. We also had two people doing it in the ladies' room.
Yeah, you told me about that.
Yeah.
You know, but if you get the right
why
guy,
why do you have people fornicating in the ladies' room?
If you get the right guy who's had a little bit too much and he goes on the dance floor, that can be very entertaining for the crowd. Like the guy that I saw, I'm not going to mention his name because I see him every once in a while. He just got in the middle of the floor, took off his jacket, and started twirling it James Brown style.
Yep.
And everybody just stood back, and he went to town to Gloria Gaynor's I Will Survive.
I was in a wedding with a guy whose nickname was Animal Head. He did the thing with the jacket.
Yeah.
He did the lawnmower.
Right.
And then he started doing...
Solo?
He started doing these crazy, like, splits, like Saturday Night. Yeah. Of course, solo.
Solo,
no
right.
woman could keep up with that.
Yeah.
Let's see. The person looking for a hookup, this person will ruin your wedding.
Mm-hmm.
And it happens.
Mm-hmm.
It does happen. I mean, it just happened at this mm-hmm. wedding that I was at. The person who shows up late, you can't be fashionably late to a wedding.
Right.
You must show up on time. At my other brother's wedding, you know who rolled in late and disrupted the whole ceremony?
Yeah.
The father of the groom.
No.
Yes.
Oh, what a tool. Are you kidding?
Yes.
That's so rude.
And his date... His future wife,
yeah.
the date was dressed like she misunderstood where we were going.
Oh, really?
He said wedding, and she thought pole dancing competition. It's an easy
yeah,
mistake
Yeah, that's not
to
a
make.
Good thing, no.
You're listening to the best of Bob and Sheri.
Absolutely.
Do you own or rent your home? Sure you do, and I bet it can be hard work. But you know what's easy? Bundling policies with Geico. Geico makes it easy to bundle your homeowners or renters insurance along with your auto policy.
It's a good thing, too, because you already have so much to do around your home. Go to geico.com, get a quote, and see how much you could save. It's Geico easy. Visit geico.com today. That's geico.com.
It's the Bob and Sheri Store's sizzling summer sidewalk sale. Everything in stock is on sale, 10% off.
10% off!
Including Sheri Lynch's cookbook, Cooking with Cats. And swag you can use, like Bob and Sheri 24-ounce latte mugs, travel mugs, H2Go water bottles, and our very hot line of Mother of All Mothers merch, including tote bags, candles, wear-around tee and sleeve shirts.
10% off!
It's the sizzling summer sidewalk sale. Everything is 10% off. Just hit shop at BobandSheri.com and use the discount code podcast at checkout. Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
A funny Valentine, sweet comic Valentine. Smile.
Singing that great American standard, My Funny Valentine, off his new album, Night Songs 2, is the man, the myth, the living legend himself, Barry Manilow, who happens to be joining us right now. Barry Manilow, welcome to the show.
Yes, that would be me, the man, the myth.
You are the man, the myth. I can't even believe, like, when Todd said, Barry Manilow is coming on the show, I was like, nuh-uh.
Is he still alive?
Well, no. I thought it was like someone had a cat named Barry Manilow. Like, the Barry Manilow is coming on our show. It is such an honor and pleasure to have
you
here.
Well, thank you. Thank you. It's great to talk to you. Thank you for playing the song.
So tell us about singing the American songbook, the
yeah,
American standards.
What calls you to that music?
You know, I'm a songwriter, and as a songwriter, these are the men that wrote those songs the best. Coming out of the 30s and 40s, the Gershwins and the Irving Berlins and the Harry Warrens, these are the guys that I always go back to when I'm stuck. What did they do when they got to the bridge? And, you know, we don't write like that anymore, but that's the great American songbook, all right. And a couple of years ago, I decided I would do one and just do a piano and vocal. Let me see what happens if I do that. And we released that one called Night Songs, and it got nominated for a Grammy. I thought, oh, goody, maybe I can do a second one. And so that's why I did volume two. But these are songs from the Great American Songbook, for me, that are not overdone. You don't hear these songs a lot. So many people have done these same songs over and over, and I decided that I would go deeper into the songbook and see what else might be there. And, boy, I found a treasure trove of beautiful, beautiful writing.
That song, it's the first cut, Everything Happens to Me.
Right.
That's the song you don't hear very often, but when I do hear it somewhere, it makes me smile because it not...
Well, in your case, it's
true. In my case, it's my life story, Barry,
Yeah, well, all of them have got they're just great ideas,
yeah.
Lyrics, great, beautiful melodies, and I just miss it, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, yes, you know, it's old-fashioned, and, you know, we have to move on, but... They're great to remind everybody that they were there.
Let me ask you, you're appearing in Vegas again with a residency.
It starts today.
That's
your new
right.
Vegas residency.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Do you
look out in the audience? And I mean, obviously, you're going to have people who come to see you year after year. Do you see younger people who are embracing these beautiful songs?
Oh, absolutely. You know, I've had the same demographic since I began. I know it sounds weird, but I looked out at the audience back in the 70s, and they were young, they were middle-aged, and they were elderly. And I look out at the audience in Vegas, and it's the same kind of thing. I think it's the style of music that I make that appeals to everybody if you like that kind of music. It's not, you know, it's not songs that only last for a decade. These songs that I'm involved with, Weekend in New England and This One's for You, I mean, it should work forever, and I think it does.
We had Elton John on once, and I was surprised that he got the lyrics and he would write to the lyrics. When you've been writing songs, how do you do it? Do you just pick the melody out of thin air?
No, that's not it. There's a little more bloodletting than that.
I bet.
But the hardest part for me as a songwriter is, what is the idea? After we get the idea, and I work with some great lyric writers, once we get the idea, well, then it's kind of fun to write. But the hard part is, what are we saying on I Made It Through the Rain or Cova Cabana? What do we want to say during this song? And that's the hard part. But once we get the idea, well, then the writing of it is kind of fun.
So you have to have a story, really.
We have to have an idea for a song. You know, Copacabana was, we wanted to write a song that was about, was like an old 1940s Technicolor musical movie.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Copacabana.
We all went to work.
Copacabana is it's a full story from beginning to end, and like so many of your songs, it's in the oxygen, right? You don't even realize that you know all the words until it comes on. My youngest daughter, Barry, we're riding in the car, and we've got one of her school friends in the back, and she's telling me about their dog. They have an English bulldog.
She's 16.
And I said, so what is the dog's name? And she goes, we named her Lola. And my daughter and I looked at each other, and my daughter said, she was a showgirl. And I looked at them and just busted up because, you know, and the two of them immediately launched into the song and started singing it. And I thought, what an accomplishment as an artist to make things like that.
I've had this demographics that have been with me forever, and I think it's because of the material. I think Copacabana is, you know, a fun song, and it doesn't end in the 70s. It's not just a 70s song. It's a song that just keeps going.
Yeah, it definitely has legs, as your career has. We're going to break very quickly and be back with Barry, if you can hang around for just a couple of more minutes. And I want to ask you about your voice. It's Bob and Sheri.
Use the Talk Back feature.
Talk Back feature.
On the free Bob and Sheri app and leave us a message.
I mean, I can't believe it, but we have Barry Manilow on the show right now. The actual legend. The actual Barry Manilow.
And that would be me.
I have a question for you. One day on the show, Bob said to me, did you know that the song, the Mandy that Barry Manilow is singing about is his dog? That can't be true. Is the Mandy in that song?
No,
is that your dog?
You know, I know where that came from. First of all, I didn't write Mandy. Clive Davis, my wonderful record producer, the executive that ran Arista Records, that was the first time I met Clive, and he said to me, you need a career-making record. So I went back and I tried writing a career-making single record, which is impossible. And then he sent me this demo of a song called Brandy, and it was a rock and roll version of Mandy, and I made it into a love song. Anyway, it became so big that the songwriter in England started to get phone calls from the press. Who's Mandy? Who's Mandy? And he, one of them woke him up, and he said, "It's my dog," and hung up on him. So, and that's the story.
That's the story behind the story.
So that's right. Where it came
yeah.
from.
Yeah. I want to ask you about your voice, Barry. You know, listening to this album, you sound the same as you did in the 70s. What have you done to be able to protect that instrument? Because a lot of singers, you know, they shred it after so many years of performing.
You know, my voice should be shredded by now, honestly. After 40-some-odd years of screaming, I write the songs and hitting a high F natural every night, you know, it shouldn't be there. And I haven't got an answer for you, because I hold my breath in the beginning of every show and in the beginning of every time I try to make a record and figure, okay, it's gone now. And so far, it's not. And I haven't got an answer. I'm just one of the lucky guys who have got a strong pair of lungs or something. I don't know. I don't take care of it that well. I don't warm up. I've never been to a singing teacher. I cross my fingers. That's it.
How about for your Vegas residency? Are you like Celine Dion? You know, you have to have certain humidity and temperature.
No.
And you get a piggyback ride to the stage.
No.
That kind of thing. No, none of it.
No. I'm just a musician who sings a little, and that's it. And I'm just, you know, a lucky guy that, you know, actually can actually sing in tune. That's it.
Do you still do in the act a little compilation of all of the jingles that you wrote when you were just coming up?
Well, you know, I tried doing that years ago, and I did that commercials medley, and it died a death because nobody remembered any of them. They stopped playing them. And I thought, oh boy, this is going to be great, just the way it always was. But since they stopped playing them, nobody knew them, what I was doing up there. But there are two that they do still play. I Am Stuck on a Band-Aid, and Like a Good Neighbor, State Farm is There. So I do a little piece of both of those.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
Isn't that great? Well, Barry, thank you so much. Good luck with the Vegas appearances, a bunch of them coming up, and the brand new hit.
Night Songs 2, that's the brand new one.
Thanks for this. You guys are just great.
Thanks so much, Barry.
We're so thrilled to have you.
Take care.
Barry Manilow, if you're heading to Vegas, you can see him perform. And Mandy is not a dog, so tell your friends.
A shareable taste of the show. The Fun Size Podcast drops every Thursday on the free Bob and Sheri app.
So I was looking at the latest issue of Glamour magazine, and they had a little top 10 list in there, Bob. And these are the 10 things that they should teach at love school. Like, if there was such a thing as love school where you went and learned about relationships and
yeah. Is my picture
and
in that
marriage,
article?
Three or four times, yeah. So these are the top 10 things that Glamour magazine says they should uh-huh. teach in love school. And, uh-huh. and let's see if we all agree with this.
Right.
Number 10, the exact location of the Vampire Diaries casting call so that you can take advantage of rejected, hot, almost TV vampires.
Oh, we're going to go this way with it.
No, this is the only one.
Is this the way we're going with it, Sheri?
That's the only one that's like that.
All right.
Number 9. How to get your man to do that thing you like without actually asking him to do that thing you like.
Why not just go ahead and ask?
Because some women are too embarrassed.
What is up with you? We'll get over that. Just get over that.
Some women are too embarrassed.
Huh? Well, I mean, just go ahead. It's your bodies are complicated enough. Just say, I want you to do this.
You know why we don't? You want me to tell you the truth why women don't?
Yeah, go ahead.
There are two reasons why we don't. Scenario number one, I tell you to do the thing that I like, and your mind goes off on a wild tear of where I learned that I like that thing. And now we've got kooky jealous. Scenario number two, I tell you to do the thing I like, and you respond with gusto and enthusiasm, and then proceed to hound me for the rest of our lives together. Well, what else do you like, dirty girl? You told me you like that. I bet you like some other stuff. Why don't you tell me what else you like? Told you one time what I liked. Does it have to become the running theme? And stop with the crazy jealous. This is why women don't tell you what we like. Because we're A, embarrassed. We're B, we're afraid you're going to wonder how we discovered we like that. And C, that you're going to think that's the opening doorway to perv town.
You know what? You know, let me tell you why you're wrong, especially about where'd you get that. Everyone's been married before, okay? So just go, just take that as the obvious.
Oh, so he was better than me. He pleased you, and I don't. And all this time, you haven't told me.
There's three guys in this room. Are any guy in this room going to be jealous if some woman says that? Go, oh, you're with somebody else.
You guys aren't that guy.
No.
But are you going to sit here and tell me you don't know that guy?
I don't. No. I'm not.
You know that guy.
I am not friends with that guy.
I'm not friends with that guy either, I don't think.
And you know a woman who's dated that guy, and don't act like you haven't. You've never known a woman who's dated the crazy jealous guy?
Oh, yeah.
Seriously?
Well, yeah, but he's not a friend of mine.
He's out there, and that's why we don't tell you. And also because it's stimulating for your mind long-term to have to guess.
How about she just has, like, flashcards, okay? Pulls out a flashcard and throws it up there,
like,
right?
Like those cards you see at the college football games they hold up on the sidelines calling the plays for the players.
Exactly.
It's got like a picture
like
of Donald Duck.
Put them right, they're right under the bed.
Right there. She holds it up right in front of you.
That's it.
I think sock puppets are good because then you can go, Mr. Socky wants to show you where it feels good. Okay.
I think that would pretty much shut me down for the night.
But then Mr. Socky.
This is why we don't tell you.
Mr. Sock Puppet.
This is something we need to market.
I love it.
Yeah.
You know what? I'll bet we could sell that.
Mr. Sock Puppet will point to what he likes. What do you think about that? Ooh, I like. Ooh, ooh.
What is this, the Ed Sullivan Show?
And then the sock puppets are going to be critiquing how you perform. Well, not that
my
good.
My college boyfriend was a little bit better at that, Mr. Sock Puppet. Number 8.
Let me get a larger sock.
Things that should... It's not the size of the sock, trust me. College boyfriend wears an ankle sock, and he got it done pretty well. Do you want to hear the rest of the list or not?
Yes.
Jeez. Things they should teach you in love school. How to have lights on confidence at all times. How to feel good about your body, and how to let go and not be so self-conscious.
Right.
Number 7. How to say, I love the thought behind this, but oh my God, please tell me you got a gift receipt. That way you don't wonder why she never wore the sweater.
Oh, I see. Okay. All right. So she can take it back. Yeah.
Number 6, how to make love last for 40 more years. They should teach us that in love
school. I agree.
Number 5, 84 different ways to say, it's not you, it's me. And 84 ways to say, listen, it's you. This time it's you. Number 4. How to tell the difference between his I'm thinking about having popcorn shrimp face and his I'm thinking of asking her to marry me face. Because a lot of times with women, your thinking face, we don't know what your thinking face is hiding.
You know, that's true. Mary will walk into the room and she'll say, what's wrong with you? What happened? I'm just sitting there reading a book.
Well, I'll ask Kevin, babe, is that your thinking face or your mad face? And he'll say, it's my tired face.
Yeah, right.
Number 3, learn how to tango in love school. It will make all the weddings you have to go to so much more fun and entertaining.
Yeah, I can understand it, but I don't want to do it.
Number 2, they should teach the art of zero regret texting. Get in there, text, and if it doesn't go the way you wanted it to go, move on. Don't beat yourself up. And the number 1 thing that Glamour magazine says they should teach us in love school. What's that? I'm so excited. Oh, sock puppet, hang on. Hang on, sock. They should teach us how to feel as romantic on a Monday in Topeka, Kansas, as we do on a Saturday in France. Oh, I feel romantic. Stop that.
People, pay attention because I do not want to have to fail you.
Bob and Sheri want you to help us salute deserving teachers. 5 winners will receive a box of school supplies, Bob and Sheri swag, a Bob and Sheri branded Visa gift card worth $100, and a 1-year Stamps.com subscription valued at $200.
4.5 gold stars for you.
Get discounted USPS and UPS postage right from your computer at Stamps.com. Use promo code Sheri to start a 4-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale.
May I have your attention? It's the Bob and Sheri Teacher Appreciation Contest.
Enter your deserving teacher at BobandSheri.com.
Leave us a talk back with the free Bob and Sheri app.
We're talking about your most romantic or sexy summer memory. Hi, Deborah.
Hi, first time caller.
Okay,
Deborah,
hey guys.
Welcome.
Thank you for listening.
You have a sexy little voice, don't you? You do.
Oh, Bob.
You do.
Oh, thank you, Bob.
Yeah.
Okay, you ready?
Uh-huh.
Mine involves the coast, and similar to Sheri's story, a fella that I had a mad, wild crush on. He knew I was alive because we worked together, but he wasn't exactly crushing back on me. But he came and got me one night from my apartment and said he wanted to show me something and drove me down to the coast line. We were in Hilton Head, so it was all coastline, but down to the beach and walked me out into the water. And the phosphorescence was in the water. I don't know if you've ever experienced that. It's like little stars in the water that attach to your skin, like little fairies. And the moon was shining out over the ocean, and the stars were all over us. And he picked me up and carried me out and laid me down on the beach. And Sheri, I don't even remember if we kissed. It was so romantic.
That is great. He picked you up?
Yeah, he did. And he was the least romantic human being on Earth. But I think, I mean, my gosh, there were stars all over our bodies. I think he was moved by that, you know, to do something.
So you just walked out there, and you're like up to your knees or something, and the stars are dancing on the wall.
He dove down into it, and so it's all in your hair.
Oh, yeah.
And all over you.
Wow.
But Bob, I have to say, as I was thinking about this, I thought, Sheri will love this. This might gross Bob out.
Yeah, because you know he's wondering what the glowing microorganisms are.
I know.
And is it possible he's going to get a rash?
Yeah, I mean, I grew up on Long Island Sound. It could be a whole different thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, stuff glowing in the water up there.
Yeah.
I don't pick up signals now from other planets, so I think okay. But
are you in a bathing suit, Deborah? Or,
I mean,
you are.
The great thing about a moment like that, Deborah, and our experiences are almost identical. The moment sweeps you both away, even if one of you isn't really feeling it, because you're a drunk with a 15-year-old girlfriend or something, you know, random like that. But isn't it great that the moment does sweep us away? Because otherwise we wouldn't have the memory.
I know. And Sheri, I really do feel, maybe you agree, that there's something about that unrequitedness of that particular situation. It's like, I get this from this relationship. This is not going to happen. It's not going to be a boyfriend girlfriend, but it just crystallizes the romance of that.
Deborah, oh my gosh, you're so right. And everyone out there, and I wish this for all children too, even though it hurts a lot, it's a sweet kind of hurt. The thing about an unrequited love where you have a single moment like this, in some ways it is the purest relationship you'll ever have. Because it always remains idealized. You never have to, Max knows what I'm talking about. You never have to grapple with the ugly, messy realities of true intimacy. It's just this aching, yearning, desperate love that's capped off by a Hollywood moment. It's perfect.
He's not the only one.
We have art and music, you know, in the world.
Yeah, I think you're so right.
He's not the only one that knows about unrequited love. I have it about myself.
I know you've never been able to love yourself.
I have it. It's pure though.
Well, that's hang on to that, Bob.
Yes, I do. I cling. I cling, Deborah.
It's nice that he can understand what we're talking about, isn't it, Deborah?
I love her.
She has a sexy voice, don't you think?
No, it's not. She's very funny and very smart.
Yeah, I know it.
Thank you.
I think you're a liar about not remembering about the kiss, Deborah.
No,
I really do.
It was so far outstripped by the stars and the whole scene.
The glowing water. Yeah.
Yeah.
I wonder where is that boy? Where is that boy these days?
Who cares?
He served his purpose in Deborah's narrative, man. He showed up and he gave Deborah that moment that every human being should have.
Yeah.
Why don't you Facebook him and try to find out? Do you even know what his name is? Do you know what his name is?
Oh yeah.
Don't, Deborah, because
Facebook.
Don't.
I have never ever tried to track down Mr. Long Beach Island for the simple reason that I don't want the reality to mess with the memory.
Exactly. exactly.
You don't want to find out that he's some pot-bellied two-time felon. You don't want that, Deborah.
No, I don't. In my mind, he's always that boy.
Let him always be that beautiful boy that carried you into the glowing surf.
Thank you, Deborah. And
kinda
thank you, Deborah's voice.
Kind of like Bob with his unrequited love. He still sees that 12-year-old in the blue blazer.
Yeah.
It's the best, Bob and Sheri.
Best.
You guys kill me. I love you, Bob and Sheri.
Oh, thank you so much.
Bob and Sheri, sponsored by Bank of America Customized Cash Rewards Credit Card. You can earn 3% cash back on online shopping, making the essentials even more rewarding. Here's Bob and Sheri.
I was reading something on BuzzFeed the other day that we talked a little bit about one of these. These are insanely creepy, freaky facts that'll blow your mind.
Uh-huh.
One of the ones on there we talked about, but BuzzFeed expanded on it.
Mm-hmm.
The average person will walk past at least 16 murderers in their lifetime.
Oh, is that right?
You always figured that at some point in your life, you walked past a murderer somewhere.
Yeah.
Airport terminal.
Right.
Fast food restaurant.
I wonder how they figured that out.
Highway rest stop.
That's an interesting figure.
16.
You know, this is awful. I thought you were going to say in a month.
Oh, no. Well, not everyone works in our business.
Yeah, right. Exactly. 16 murderers in your lifetime.
I am such a twisted weirdo. I often wonder how many close encounters I've had with serial killers who are still on the loose and unfound.
One of the scariest things that ever happened to me, I was just talking to my daughter about it because, you know, you have to teach your kids that you want them to love people and be kind, but you have to be cautious too.
Yeah.
And I told you guys about this when it happened. I was living all alone at the time in a house at the end of a cul-de-sac. And it was the last house in that road at the end of the cul-de-sac.
Mm-hmm.
2 o'clock in the afternoon, there's knocking at my door. And I go and I look through the glass and there's this sweaty, disheveled looking middle-aged businessman standing on my front steps. And there's something about him that's off.
Mm-hmm.
My gut immediately went, there's something wrong here.
Right.
So without opening the door, I said, can I help you? And he said, yeah, my car broke down and I just need to use your phone. Well, Chief, you had to go past 13 other houses to find mine.
Yeah.
And there were a lot of stay-at-home moms in my neighborhood then, and they were home.
Yeah.
So you went to the last house on the end of the lane.
Yeah.
Where nobody could hear me scream.
What did you do?
I said, I'm sorry, can't do it. Come on, help me out here. I said, nope, sorry, can't do it. And I stepped back into the shadows
mm-hmm.
where he couldn't see me.
Mm-hmm.
And I watched him and the look on his face.
Mm-hmm.
And then he turned around and walked back down my driveway and back down the road. And
why didn't he go to the house next door?
Why didn't he?
Because I know that house you're talking about.
Why didn't he go to one of the 13 other houses, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't know. I can't prove nothing bad happened.
Yeah.
But in my heart and in my gut, I've always believed that if I had opened my door, that would have been it for me.
Mm-hmm.
And so I tell my daughters, like, when your gut, when everything in your body is saying no.
Mm-hmm.
Listen to it.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's another fascinating and creepy fact. More than 1,600 people have gone missing in U.S. national parks.
Vanished. Wow, just in parks?
Vanished without a trace. Now,
but now then again, there's a lot of wilderness.
That's not all foul play, or maybe none of it's foul play.
Yeah,
people get lost, but then they're never found.
I mean, some of our national parks are true wilderness. You know, I mean, some, you know, there's stores and there's places that are entertainment oriented, but you get out in Yellowstone or you get out in
Yosemite.
Yosemite, I mean.
Grand Teton.
Yeah, I could see how somebody would not
Grand
come back.
The Grand Canyon.
Right.
By the time anybody could maybe find you, you could be dead of exposure.
Yeah.
People just disappear.
You know what it is? It's people who are not really outdoors people and they want to see something that's really magnificent and they... They get lost.
They think because it's a national park that nothing bad can happen.
Yeah.
Let's see. Here's another one. There's a parasite in cat feces that can control the mind of a rat if the rat eats it.
Please. Thank you. It controls the mind of the rat in what way? It tells the rat to do certain things.
things.
You know, since you mentioned it, it's controlling my mind right now. I'm with the rat.
There's a zombie fungus that basically enslaves ants for its own benefit until it kills them. A zombie fungus. You know, fungi are alive.
Mm-hmm.
And the fungi has its own agenda and motivation for feeding and reproducing. Mm. And it controls these ants. And then when it's had its, the ants have served their purpose, it kills them.
Mm.
A jellyfish's mouth is also a jellyfish's anus.
Yeah, I did know that.
Oh, is that right?
Which is a similar scenario.
Yeah, yeah.
Look at this.
Yeah.
Over there.
We've met the same people,
and,
I see.
And may I say, spineless as a jellyfish.
Yeah, that's true. Wow. That's true.
Hey, look at this one. He's talking on his own. Yes, he is.
Literally, yeah.
Woo! The last person on Earth to have lived in the 19th century, died a few weeks ago. Emma Moreno, we talked about her. Yeah. She was born November 29th, 1899.
That is amazing, isn't it?
Yeah. Isn't that spectacular?
Man, what she saw. I mean, the difference between the year 1700 and 1775, there was a difference. But between 1899 and now?
And finally, you're not going to like this, Bob. There are teeny microscopic bugs that live on your face. Mm. And eat dead skin.
Mm. Wow. Well, thanks for all that.
It's Bob and Sheri.
People, pay attention because I do not want to have to fail you.
Bob and Sheri want you to help us salute deserving teachers. Five winners will receive a box of school supplies, Bob and Sheri swag, a Bob and Sheri branded Visa gift card worth $100, and a one-year Stamps.com subscription valued at $200.
4.5 gold stars for you.
Get discounted USPS and UPS postage right from your computer at Stamps.com. Use promo code Sheri to start a 4-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale.
May I have your attention? It's the Bob and Sheri Teacher Appreciation Contest.
Enter your deserving teacher at bobandsheri.com.
The Bob and Sheri website, the Oddcast, contest info, bobandsheri.com.
All right, we are so excited because Yvette is joining us right now. And Yvette, I'm so jealous because Yvette got to play Robin Redbreast in the school play. Are we saying it right? Are you Yvette or Yvette? How do you pronounce yours?
Well, if we were in Paris, it would be Yvette. But here in Kentucky, it's Yvette.
Yvette. So you were Robin Redbreast.
Hmm. Yes, are you so jealous?
I'm so jealous. So you were both adorable and you can sing.
Mm. I couldn't sing, though. I mean, I didn't get to sing like a solo.
How did you get picked? Because that's the star of the spring play. Is this kindergarten or first grade for you?
I'm crossing the river and you can't hear me. On a second.
Well, put the oar in the water a little deeper. Get over there fast.
Okay, here I am.
It's
just this one little spot where you can't get covered. So yes, I was Robin Redbreast, but I didn't get to sing a solo, and now I feel slighted.
So what were you? Was this first grade or kindergarten when you were chosen to be the star?
It was second grade, there was a song, and I danced, but I didn't get to sing a solo.
Are you a high maintenance woman, Yvette? I'm just wondering.
Maybe. No, I'm very selfish.
I mean, you were still out front, right? I mean, why didn't they let you sing? Do you not have a great voice?
You guys, I'm sorry. You keep cutting out.
Oh, no.
Okay, wait. Are you there?
I'm here.
This isn't going to be very good on live radio, is it?
This is. I feel like I'm talking to the Lewis and Clark expedition. You're on the river.
Yeah, we've done a lot worse, Yvette. We're fine with you.
Okay, well, anyway, I'm driving through mountains over the river, and that's what life is like here. So, but yeah, they have you, my little role was to dress up like the little robin with a little red breast, little black wings, and dance around the stage while all the other second graders sang the song.
Well, I mean, you're not Britney Spears dancing. I mean, even Britney Spears can't dance and sing, right? There's a track, right? So they were probably saying, just let her be the dancer, and the kids will handle the singing.
I believe it was highly choreographed.
The Robin Redbreast in my spring play that I was so jealous of, she had wings. And during her song, she flapped her wings. And I just thought nothing in life would ever mean anything again because I didn't get to do that. Yeah. Did you have wings?
I totally actually had wings, big black wings, and I flapped them around. Yes. I don't remember having a tail to wiggle, though. In the song, it talks about wiggling your tail. They might not have let the second graders do that.
I hope
they
not.
They definitely did in a Catholic school. Yeah, I'm not. Just going to tell you. Bob knew a song that I had never heard before about brown squirrel. Brown squirrel. Did you do that in a school play, or did one of your kids do that?
No, one of my kids did. My kids did. Brown squirrel, shake your bushy tail.
Bushy tail.
Hold
it. That was my sorority song. We did gray squirrel, swish your bushy tail.
That was your sorority song?
In the sorority?
Yeah.
Well, Yvette, aren't you an interesting woman?
Yeah, I was going to say.
I'm all about the dancing animals, right?
I'm trying to picture Bob with his daughter coming home. Our sorority song involves me shaking my bushy tail. I just don't see it.
I don't think I can pay for that particular sorority. God.
Well, that was an in-house deal. It's not like we did it at rush parties or anything.
I got it. I got the feeling you did, though, actually, Yvette, to be honest with you.
Maybe.
What do you do as a grown-up? What's your life like now?
I'm the director of a lawyer assistance program, and I help lawyer with substance abuse and mental health issues get treatment.
So when the lawyers themselves are struggling, you step in.
Yes. Yes. I was a lawyer, practiced law for 20 years, and then took over this position a few years ago.
My youngest has announced that she wants to be a federal prosecutor who also dances. Yvette,
perfect.
She can shake her bushy tail.
Yeah, I was just about to say.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of dancing in federal court. You can believe that.
Well, as a lawyer with so much experience in life, and as a woman who's shaking her bushy tail on stage, what advice do you have that I can share with my youngest, the dancing federal prosecutor?
Self-care. It is a very difficult profession. It's a very competitive business. And if you don't take good care of yourself, you're just susceptible to all sorts of problems. So if you exercise self-care, you'll love. I loved it. I loved practicing law. But it's a hard way to make a living.
So how many lawyers are struggling? Like, what number annually come through your organization? Because you never really stop and think about that.
I know. I've never heard of this position before. It's terrific.
Most states have a lawyer assistance program. North Carolina has an awesome one. And the numbers nationally, they just did a survey a couple of years ago. Lawyers suffer from substance use disorders at a rate about 5 times higher than the general population.
Oh, my gosh.
The general population is between 6% and 8%, and we're about between 20% and 35%, depending on the.
Wow.
What do you think the reason for that is? Having been a lawyer,
some of the research looks like it's because it's a conflict-based process, and that kind of stimulates different things in your brain, like adrenaline and cortisol, and those things seem to create depression.
And sometimes
and so there's a lot of self-medicating.
Sometimes you are defending somebody that you may not like at all, but they still need to have a lawyer, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. There's an inner conflict in that. So not only do you have the exterior conflict, you have an inner conflict.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, Bob told me once, he has an old friend who's a lawyer, and Bob said, I don't know. He's so argumentative. And if you think about it, that would make some sense, right?
Well, I have another friend who was a lawyer and a successful one. He said, if I had to do all over again, I think I would have done something differently. And I know some guys, some women love it.
Because of the conflict.
Yeah.
Yvette, I'm glad you made it safely across the river. Keep up the good work with the lawyers.
Thank you so much, Yvette,
for listening.
Yep.
It's Bob and Sheri.
Leave us a talk back with the free Bob and Sheri app.
And I was in Jersey last weekend for my niece, my goddaughter's wedding, and we had lots and lots and lots of exciting things happen. And it was the next day when my brother and his wife threw kind of an all-day barbecue after party so that people who had traveled from far away could get together and hang out. It was glorious, and they roasted a pig. It was really a great time. And so I got to catch up with a lot of family members some of them I haven't seen since Caramia was born. That's how long it's been.
Oh, boy.
So this one, and I'm not going to name names, but this one family member who is very, very colorful, she's the one who peed in the bushes at the country club because locked the ladies' room.
Yeah, yeah.
And when I said, I'm impressed because in that dress, I don't know how you got it done. And she said, oh, you just pull it up over your hips and squat. It was nothing. So we got into a kind of intense conversation about tattoos and piercings. She has a daughter, and now this is a woman with a lot of tattoos. She's got a lot of ink, but she doesn't want her daughter to get tattoos. She said, I don't regret mine, but I don't want my daughter to get it. And she said,
not one.
She said, well, I take that back. Now, I'm going to try to do her. I'm going to try to talk just like her because it was so riveting. The way she talks, her pronunciations, her rhythm, everything. Now, I'm going to try to clean this up. But I need everybody who listens to this, I need you to use your imagination because this is a visual, okay? Because I can't really say the exact words she said. She said, well, there is this one tattoo I regret. I did not regret it when I got it, Cher. But when I got it, I was a big girl, and I've lost a lot of weight. And she has. She looks great. I've lost a lot of weight. So when I got this tattoo, it really worked for me, but I did not anticipate what would happen when I lost the weight. So she scoops up her hair, and she turns around, and on the back of her neck, filling the back of her neck, is a tattoo. And she says, now you look at that, and you tell me what it looks like today, and I'll tell you what it looked like when I was fat. So when she got the tattoo, it was a beautiful, vivid, very detailed, open-petaled pink rose.
I know what it looks like.
Now, I want you to take that pink rose, and I want you to take your two hands, and I want you to press that pink rose together until it forms like a long, slender, rippled oval.
We all know what that is.
And I said, I see it. She says, you see it? How could you not see it? It's a bleep on the back of my neck. Now, she's sitting next to my nephew.
I thought you were just talking privately.
No, this is at a table with all the...
Oh, my God. Are you kidding?
My children, my nieces and nephews.
She's talking like that out loud?
So she's sitting next to my nephew, who's in his early 20s now. And she said... Look at it. Look at it, Rye. And he looks at it. And now he just... And she goes, hey, how would you like to lick that?
Oh, no. She did not say that, Sheri.
Yes, she did. Except I'm editing, remember?
Yeah, I know.
I'm editing out all of the...
Oh, my word. Was she drunk?
No.
Oh, my word. Hey, talk about a pain in the neck.
She said, and when it gets hot, I like to wear my hair up, you know, because it's hot and I like to wear my hair up. But now I wear my hair up and I'm standing in line at the grocery store with a on the back of my neck. And people, you know, people are looking and they're saying stuff like, I think that lady's got it on the back of her neck.
What happens when she gets a stiff neck?
Then she said, and if, okay, because then she said, so I add it to the tattoo, and she turns around, she lifts her hair, so now we've got the on the back of her neck, and there are these really, really detailed, beautifully calligraphied letters, and she says, that's my kid's initials.
No! Oh, no! Why did she put him there?
Because at the time, Bob, it was a beautiful, fluffy, blossoming rose. And now it isn't. So I was like really surprised because, I mean, I know when you lose weight everywhere.
Yeah.
But I didn't realize that you could lose so much weight that
it would collapse
neck,
it. Yeah.
That your neck would change that much.
Oh, yeah.
So the moral of the story.
Keep eating.
And the cautionary tale here is when you go to your tattoo artist, and I have one, so I'm not judging. When you go to your tattoo artist, ask yourself, what would this look like if I took two hands and squeezed it together?
Oh,
and also ask yourself,
word,
if once you have something on your body that looks like that, if it's ever a good idea to turn to your 25-year-old nephew and say, hey, you want to lick it? And let me answer for you. The answer is no.
You're listening to the best of Bob and Sheri.
Absolutely.
Swag you can use. Just hit shop at bobandsheri.com.
I am such a time-wasting weirdo. I really am.
Hey, you don't need to explain. Is anyone putting up a fight in here?
I thought about that the other day.
I said, a time-wasting weirdo?
You know
weirdo?
What? You are a time-wasting weirdo. If you took the time that you waste doing things that you'll never be a part of or thinking about things that you cannot do and took that time to figure out a way to make more money or figure out like an invention.
Or to do the things you can do.
Or do the things you can do. You'd be so much better off. And I'll give you an example. I'd love to go to Lowe's. I do. I like walking around
what
it.
What is it Lowe's for you?
You know, not much. Because I can't fix a damn thing. But
and you don't build stuff.
I don't know how to build anything. I can't. If you gave me like a jigsaw, I would not know what to do with it. I just figure if I walk around those aisles long enough, somehow it's going to seep in and I'll be able to figure something out. And once in a while, like I'll say, oh, well, there's a thing I could figure out. You can roll up your garden hose with this thing. I should get that because I'm leaving it out all over the place, right? I love this thing and I'll buy that, right? But the thing where I really waste time, it's not so much walking around, you know, the different departments and Lowe's. Sometimes I actually do learn something about fertilizer for the flowers or something. Every time I go and I look around and make sure that there's no one that I know, like my wife looking at me, I always stop at the, you know, the magazine section they have at Lowe's?
Yeah.
You know those? I always stop and look at the How to Build Your Own Log Cabin magazine.
You have wanted this since the day I met you.
And I stand there. And I go through it and I say, well, I don't like that one at all. That one is, I don't like those windows. Oh, that's a nice one. That's the one that I would have. That one right there. Look at that. Look at the view I could be enjoying. And I'm going through it and I'm this close to buying a hard copy for like $25, Cabins of America. And I'm thinking, you don't know how, you have to call Kevin. You know, when the washer or dryer bouncing around.
He's going to come fix your weather stripping on the door.
Oh, okay. Great.
So that's covered.
Yeah. Like, I can't do that. I can't do that. And yet, here I am, you know, Bob of the Great Outdoors, looking at a cabin that I would like to have.
But just because you can't do a small thing doesn't mean that you can't do a big thing. For example, I cannot cross-stitch my initials on a piece of fabric, but I wrote a book.
Yeah.
So maybe you can't fix the weather stripping on your front door, but you could build a cabin.
I could not build
maybe
a cabin.
Maybe you could.
I could.
Maybe
not
you could. Now, the attention span piece of it, I get a little worried because you can't build a cabin in an afternoon. You're going to have sustained cabin building commitment for a long time.
Cabin fever.
I was just going
to
say.
Yeah. I'd have to have cabin fever of another sort.
You know what? Your property, your yard is so heavily wooded and you have deer. It's so pretty. What if, this is just a thought, what if we built you a tiny log cabin?
Well, that's an idea.
And you could go out in it with a glass of wine and sit in the tiny cabin and watch the deer. And I am not, if you think I'm making fun of you, you're wrong. I'm not talking about
why
one of those.
Why were you laughing then would be my question.
Because I know you're thinking that I'm talking about one of those plastic Fisher-Price cabins. No, I'm saying Kevin builds you a real, like a tiny house, a miniature log cabin that's big enough just for you.
Oh, yeah, that's a good idea. And then my stepdaughter, who, by the way, starts high school this fall, could talk about me. What is your stepfather like? He's the guy on the radio, right? Yeah, he is. He has a tiny log cabin, and he goes there in the early evening hours and drinks wine alone, looking at the deer.
You know, when you say it like that, it doesn't even sound that dysfunctional.
It sounds almost meditative.
It could be your meditation cabin.
Yeah.
There you go.
And maybe you build it so there's room, like not for a couch, but like for a love seat. And you and Mary, as the kids get older and they're louder and they have friends over and they want to have parties and stuff, you and Mary could go to the cabin.
I am tired of being driven from homes. I'm just why am I always being driven from my home?
That's not the right way to look at it.
But that's what the bottom line is. The kid's taking over the house. There's a wife that's not driving me out. It's a kid.
I'm sorry. You're right. This is not the first time we've tried to build a tiny house for you.
That's right.
In the backyard.
I'm always being driven from my home. And I always pay for the homes. It's not right. This is why I guess I'm just better off just wasting time at Lowe's.
But you have to admit, it's not a bad thing to think about.
Yeah.
In that back natural area nestled in the trees.
I would like to build it myself.
But maybe a little fire pit outside?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But as soon as that buzz saw started and I start to move the buzz saw into the wood, all I'm going to be thinking about
are your
fingers. You could lose a finger just like that.
You're listening to the best of Bob and Sheri.
Absolutely.
Instant access to the podcast, and fun side. Just download the free Bob and Sheri app.
I was reading this article about the best romantic comedies that were set in London during the 1990s. So that's a really specific time and place.
Notting Hill?
Notting Hill is there, yeah. I've seen, I think,
Four Weddings and a Funeral.
All of them. That's the one I'm looking at, 1994 right now.
You've Got Mail.
No,
that's New York.
That's You've Got Mail is New York City.
Love Actually is in the 2000s.
Set in London. Oh, I'm sorry.
So here they are, and I think there's only one that I have not seen, and I don't know that I've ever even heard of it, and I can't believe it's in like the top five of these London movies set in the 1990s. I'll run down the movies. Four Weddings and a Funeral from 1994. Notting Hill, you're right, 1999. That's great. Bridget Jones' Diary. That's actually 2001, but they About a Boy is in there, 2002, and Love Actually, which is around the same era. The one that I have not seen, and it sounds really interesting, is Sliding Doors.
Oh, I know
with
this
Gwyneth
movie.
Gwyneth Paltrow. It's so good.
So the premise of this movie is she goes and finds her. I guess her husband is having an affair on her, and what they do is they show her coming back to the apartment, I think, and the sliding doors have to do with like the subway that she gets on.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's her boyfriend.
It's her boyfriend. It's not a husband.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a long time. It's been 20 years since I've seen it.
Right. Continue.
So, but the idea is that that little things happen in our lives. And they can alter what the trajectory of our lives are going to be. Little minuscule things like the sliding doors.
Yeah, so it's a movie that has alternate.
Right, in the one
realities.
Scene from what I'm reading here, one part of it, she discovers that her boyfriend was cheating, and she goes in another direction. And then in the other way, she is oblivious to his cheating, and her life goes into another direction. Is that correct?
Yes.
And the whole concept is, it's amazing how just one second, one movement, one choice
alters your reality,
alters your entire life.
You should watch it. You should get it on demand and watch it. It's so good. And the guy that plays her boyfriend is also in Four Weddings and a Funeral. And I forget his name. He's a Scottish actor, I think.
John Hannah.
Yeah, he's wonderful.
John
it's
Hannah.
Really, really
right.
good.
And the film is packed with London locales. Fat Boys Diner, Trinity Buoy, Wharf. Blue Anchor Club. I guess these are all great bars and restaurants in London. It's an interesting concept that making one choice can just change your life forever. Walking into one restaurant with a friend who introduces you to somebody that you have never known before, but now you're dating.
Can't you think of at least one instance in your life where one choice changed everything?
Oh, I can think of just so many.
Yeah.
And I mean, changed my life.
Yeah. It's like that.
Would not be here with you without those changes.
Oh, exactly. It's like that.
And sometimes it's just like a spur of the moment thing, you know? It's a spur of the moment thing. Like, I'm getting ready to go to college and I'm working in this plastics factory. I'm like 19 and I'm driving home and I hear on the radio that this news guy for a radio station was quitting to go into the hardware business. I think he made a good choice. And I went, I know where that radio station is. And I drove over to it. I went in and applied for it. And they gave me the job at 19 reading the news. Now, if I hadn't done that at that moment.
Who knows, right?
Who knows? Who knows if I'd have the chutzpah to, I don't know, somehow put together a tape to bring to a radio station. But I had no experience. I had no recording to say, this is what I sounded like. So suppose I didn't hear him giving it up on the air that day. And I said to myself, there's no way that you can get a job in that business. You have absolutely no experience. Wouldn't be here.
I was in grad school in Philly at Temple when I got the phone call that my father had been granted parole. The time he was in prison was the most peaceful and happiest time of my entire life. And I knew that when he got out, he would begin terrorizing me again. And I just had no more patience or energy for it. Now, I was in school on a free ride. I had a full free ride to do my MFA at Temple. At the end of my first year, my father got paroled. A guy I had dated in college said to me, I'm going to go work on a movie in Wilmington, North Carolina. They're hiring. Why don't you come?
Yeah, the Dino De Laurentiis studio was there, right?
You know me, like in school. School is my everything.
Right.
I was so unwilling to deal with meth crazy anymore that I was like, you know what? Yep. I filed for a leave of absence from school, took that job, and my entire life changed. Would not be sitting here.
Yeah. Now you went back to college.
I went back and got a master's degree later, but paid for that one.
Yeah.
But I don't regret it. I couldn't have any more abuse. I just couldn't do it.
Yeah, that one.
I'd had enough
piece of knowledge.
Well, I'd had enough. When you've never had peace, you don't even know what peace is.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you get peace and safety.
Uh-huh.
And then somebody threatens that and you're like, no, Satan, no.
You know, that must.
I'm out of here.
That must have felt like heaven.
It did.
To have no outward pressure from somebody who was out of control.
Well, you have to understand that I had been frightened, like bodily terrified for my entire life mm-hmm. until they locked him up.
You know what you
And then they let him out?
You remind
oh,
me.
Oh, I don't think so.
They reminded me of the Julia Roberts movie where she's terrorized by
sleeping with the enemy.
Sleeping with the enemy, and then she escapes to a Midwestern town and she has this little bungalow house and she's so peaceful.
Yeah.
Because she's away from that guy.
And then that guy comes back, and you're like, yeah, no.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
It's Bob and Sheri.
People, pay attention, because I do not want to have to fail you.
Bob and Sheri want you to help us salute deserving teachers. 5 winners will receive a box of school supplies, Bob and Sheri swag, a Bob and Sheri branded Visa gift card worth $100, and a 1-year Stamps.com subscription valued at $200.
4.5 gold stars for you.
Get discounted USPS and UPS postage right from your computer at Stamps.com. Use promo code Sheri to start a 4-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale.
May I have your attention. It's the Bob and Sheri Teacher Appreciation Contest.
Enter your deserving teacher at bobandsheri.com.
The Off-Air Podcast. The Bob and Sheri Oddcast. Download on the free Bob and Sheri app, website, or wherever you get your podcasts. It's Bob and Sheri.
eHarmony took a look at what are the most dateable jobs right now for people on the eHarmony site. In other words, what kind of a guy would you like today? What type of profession would you like him to be in? What's
or
attractive?
Her,
or her. Okay. Or her. It's what's the sexiest is what it comes down to. And here they are. Here's the top 10. Doctor or nurse, teacher or professor, veterinarian, firefighter or police officer, engineer or architect, lawyer, computing and IT, artist or designer, office worker, and then writer. The biggest turnoff job is politician. Who would you, I mean, if I have never dated anybody because of their profession. It's never been a turn on for me at all.
One of my girlfriends told us, we were sitting around drinking wine one night, and she said, listen, if you don't date a lot of cops and soldiers while you're single, why are you even single?
Is that what she said?
She said they're just so hot. Hot, hot, hot.
Really?
Yeah.
I think dating a police officer long term, I think.
Because
they're I'm that just so much pressure.
As someone who is just so into like forensics and crime and murder, I don't know how I missed a cop. I do not
yeah,
know how
that's
I didn't
true.
Bag a cop.
That's true. You know, it would be hard for him, though, because every day when he comes home, you'd be asking him constantly, what'd you see today?
Yeah.
Oh, my wife would be that way. What'd you do today? Did you arrest anybody today? What was weird that you saw today?
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever dated anybody that because of their profession. I think it would be interesting to date a person who's a writer. A woman, you know, mm-hmm. who's a yeah. writer. I think that would be interesting.
As long as she's not writing about me. Do you know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah, that's
and
true.
Murder.
I think a nurse would be an attractive person.
A lot of
person.
Men I know have a nurse fantasy.
Yeah.
But there's the nurse fantasy, and here's the reality of a nurse. Because we've had so many nurses on the show who've told us, I have dealt with people all day. You're on your own.
You know, you're right. I remember the last one who said that. The guy is bleeding from the mouth, and it's like, yeah.
He's like, don't you want to take care of me? No, I don't.
I wonder if I would want to date a woman who's a lawyer. Not because I think that she would be argumentative. I'm going to put that aside. But they're very detail-oriented. Like, I have a friend who's a lawyer. He's a guy, and he calls my cell phone. And I think I left my leave a message recording on the cell phone around 25 years ago because I've had the same phone, right? So he calls and I'm not picking it up and it says, hi, this is Bob. I'm not here right now. Please leave a message. I'll get back to you. So he finally gets back to me and he said, what's with your message? And I said, what are you talking about?
Oh my God.
He said, well, it's not that you're not here right now. You just didn't pick it up right now. It's a cell phone. It's not like the phone is on the wall of your kitchen and you've driven away. You're not there right now. I'm kind of freestyle in my life. If I had somebody that was picking on me like that, it wouldn't go good.
Don't date an engineer.
Oh, yeah. God, that's
the,
right.
The comedian John Mulaney, both of his parents are lawyers. And he said that when your parents are lawyers and you're a kid, it's really hard. And he has this hysterically funny bit that we could probably play because I think it's clean. But his dad would come into his room holding his toothbrush when he was like 8 years old. John, is this your toothbrush? And John would say, yes. So we both agree, this is your toothbrush.
I did see you, where that's going.
Did you brush your teeth? Yes, I did. And yet this toothbrush is dry. Right? And then he said his mom was more like Nancy Grace, just throwing crazy accusations and waiting for something to stick. So, I think those would be challenging.
Well, I mean, you're just trained to analyze everything. And
argue.
I say, I'm kind of freestyle.
And argue.
You know, so there's going to be a lot of things to point out if you're married to me. Yeah, dateable jobs.
I think that you... And definitely I did, but you and I don't do well with people that follow us around picking apart everything we say.
No. That's no way for me to live.
We won't. I mean, we'll just be
just
miserable.
Just
we'll
be
make the other person
and
miserable.
And they'll be miserable, too. You're exactly right.
You're listening to the best of Bob and Sheri.
Absolutely.
Instant access to the podcast, and fun side. Just download the free Bob and Sheri app.
All right, we're talking about mementos from a past love that you've held on to and what they are and why you're keeping them. And Meredith joins us right now with some steamy love letters. Good morning, Meredith.
Good morning.
Are they one guy or more than
one guy?
One guy. Yep. One guy.
The first love.
How old were you?
I was between the ages of 18 and 24.
And he was good at writing love letters?
He was really good just at writing all around. But when he wrote a love letter, it was just epic. And it's so epic that I just held on to them. I really could not ever bear to part with them.
Good for you.
And where do you keep them? Where do you keep the love letters?
I keep them in a secret treasure chest at my mom's house.
Because you don't want your current husband to find them?
Exactly. Oh, so, he would be mortified. He would not know what to make of that.
And he doesn't know they exist?
No.
You don't have one with you right now?
Oh, gosh, no, I don't, but I so wish I did.
Can you share some of what you remember?
Yeah.
Like, what was so awesome about these love letters?
Well, okay, honestly, I think what was so awesome about them was just the way they made me feel, you know, and I wanted to be able to hold on to that or revisit that feeling in the future if it never happened again, you know what I mean?
So what words do you, and I know you recall some of them,
what
words jumped out?
I think I'd be censored, like, the whole thing would probably have to be censored.
Oh, really?
I mean, very complimentary terminology having to do with my
creamy
body.
Skin, your luscious, blah, 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 that kind of thing?
Yeah, pretty much if you read like a romance novel and, you know, go through like one of the love scenes, some of the letters were a bit like that.
Wow. So your beauty and your splendiferousness caused his manhood to strain earnestly against its khaki prison?
Exactly. You took the words I had in my mouth. Mm-hmm.
So,
it happens.
What was his first name, Meredith?
I don't know if I should say that because I don't know.
People know who Meredith is.
It's hidden. It's hidden in your mother's, your secret treasure chest,
no,
whatever the hell that
she
is.
She has plausible deniability because it could be another Meredith who's having this conversation right now.
Exactly. Okay, his name was Sam.
No, it wasn't.
Yep.
No, it wasn't.
Yep, and he was a talented writer, that one.
Mm. So whatever happened with you two?
Well, we were together off and on for several years, and then we just parted ways. We both wanted different things, and it was just one of those kind of crossroads situations, and we had to move on. It was the hardest breakup I've ever been through, and to this day, you know, still affects me, but I'm very, very happy with my husband, though.
That's what I was going to ask. You have a great guy now. That's great.
Oh, yeah. He's amazing.
Yeah. He's oblivious, but he's a great guy. Now, how often do you go on Facebook and check out this guy, Sam?
Well, we're friends, and so, I don't know, maybe once every couple of months I'll look in on him and see what's going on, and, you know, I just, you know, because people that you've been close to in the past, I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I get curious to, you know, see how they're doing or what their kids are doing.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah, like, of course. Has he moved on too? Is he married now or in a relationship?
Yes, he's married to a really great girl, and they have a little baby, and they both look really, really happy, so that's good.
What did he name the baby? Was it a girl?
Well, I definitely can't say that, because then everyone really will know, because it's a very distinct name. Okay. The baby's.
I don't think his name was Sam. I think it was Dave.
I think his name is Sam because Meredith doesn't sound like someone who's capable of lying, which is why she has to keep the letters at her mom's house. Because she's just
not
a good liar.
I cannot get away with lying to save my life.
Yeah,
I really can't.
I can hear it in your voice.
Where's the treasure chest? Up in the attic?
It is. Yes, it's up in the attic. And
why don't you get the mom's address and ruin her life? God, you know, I mean, I'm nosy, but you're really a toke over the line,
Cuso. Sorry, I'm sorry. The sexy music in the background, it did something to me.
God, could you just pry a little bit more? So sorry, Meredith.
I'm sorry, Meredith. Well,
where's your mother live? Is there a security system?
She lives one town away.
Does she have a dog?
I'd like to hear. I mean, I'm just going to be honest. I'd like to hear some of those letters.
Well, maybe Meredith, maybe you could call up one morning and we'll change your name and you could read them on the air.
Yeah.
I've got to tell you real quick that my younger sister is the only person who knows that these exist. And it's because when I was writing up things like a will, because I have kids now, I told my sister, I said, explicitly, you must seize all written materials from my life. You are in charge of that. I said, if you find anything from Sam, get rid of it. Like, don't let anyone see it. Don't let anyone see it, you know?
Meredith, you have got to call back and read some of these on the air.
I can't stand it.
I've got to know.
People, pay attention because I do not want to have to fail you.
Bob and Sheri want you to help us salute deserving teachers. 5 winners will receive a box of school supplies, Bob and Sheri swag, a Bob and Sheri branded Visa gift card worth $100, and a 1-year Stamps.com subscription valued at $200.
4.5 gold stars for you.
Get discounted USPS and UPS postage right from your computer at Stamps.com. Use promo code Sheri to start a 4-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale.
May I have your attention? It's the Bob and Sheri Teacher Appreciation Contest.
Enter your deserving teacher at BobandSheri.com.
The Bob and Sheri website, the Oddcast, contest info, BobandSheri.com.
Hi, Cindy. How are you?
Hi, I'm okay. How are you?
Good, thank you. What was the middle school angst that you went through?
I was actually in the ninth grade, so I just started high school. And I can still remember the girls' names. But for some reason, I was being accused of stuffing my bra, which you know, in middle school is, Sheri, you know.
It's like being accused of crimes against humanity. Yeah, it's the worst.
Yeah.
And you weren't stuffing your bra, were you, Cindy?
No. And this had gone on for like 2 weeks. I had told my mom. I was just humiliated. And, I mean, they went as far as writing it on the girls' bathroom mirrors with a Sharpie.
No.
Yeah. So
why were they focused on you? I mean, were you well endowed?
And they were jealous.
Did you develop early? Was that it?
No, I was actually flat chested as they come.
Huh.
So they were just picking on that to pick on you? That's weird. Okay, so then what happened?
So one day they were walking behind me in the hallway, and there were three of them. And they were going, well, if you don't really stuff your bra, why don't you just prove it? Why don't you just prove it? And I threw my book down in the middle of the hall, ripped my shirt off, and ripped my bra off in the middle of the hallway.
Wow! Holy moly!
I absolutely lost it.
Were there a bunch of other kids walking through the hall?
We were switching classes.
Wow!
I mean, the halls were full.
You showed your breast to the whole hallway?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I was screaming at them.
And you were screaming?
Oh, yeah. I was like, does that make you feel better?
And five boys said, yeah. Yeah, sure did, Cindy. What was the reaction and what happened to you?
Oh, you could have heard a pin drop in the hall. I mean, everybody was like, ooh.
I'll bet.
You took your bra off.
Oh, yeah. I threw my books. I took my shirt off, and I ripped my bra off.
Wow, you're ferocious.
In middle school.
You're so ferocious, Cindy.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, it was awful.
What happened? Did the assistant principal call you in?
Oh, well, of course, the teachers come running out in the hall, and I got took to the principal's office, and I got suspended for 3 days.
You know, why is it that as adults, we don't look at a situation like that and ask ourselves, hey, why was Cindy topless in the hall?
Yeah.
Could it be that Cindy is the victim of torture by her classmates?
Oh, yeah.
Like, why is the victim always the one who's in trouble?
Hey, Cindy, one thing you can be glad for, they didn't have cell phones back then.
Oh, yeah. Tell me about it.
You know, Cindy,
I'm so glad I didn't grow up in the world of technology.
Mm-hmm.
Cindy, you gave...
I've been a YouTube sensation.
You gave many people an indelible lifetime memory.
That's right.
And you stood up for yourself. You go, girl.
I'm sure those three girls still think about me.
And not in a good way. So
exactly.
Good for you.
It's the best Bob and Sheri.
The best.
You guys kill me. I love you, Bob and Sheri.
Oh, thank you so much.
Hey, thank you so much for listening to the Bob and Sheri podcast and the Bob and Sheri Oddcast. We would love if you would subscribe, rate and review, and share it with a friend on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, wherever you go. And thank you again for listening.
Hey, I'm EJ Dixon.
And I'm Brittany Spanos.
We're both Rolling Stone writers. Brittany covers pop music, fandom, and race.
And EJ reports on everything internet culture related, from influencers to far-right extremist groups to OnlyFans.
And we both spend an insane amount of time on TikTok.
Literally so many hours.
Every single day.
My feed is all wacky family stories, aesthetically pleasing cooking videos, and hot guys.
And mine is primarily Y2K makeup tutorials, true crime conspiracy theories, and bisexual thirst traps.
So it feels right that we put all of those hours of scrolling and laughing on our phones to more productive use.
That's why we're hosting Don't Let This Flop, a weekly podcast about what's happening on TikTok.
We'll keep you up to date on the big trends, the wackiest stories, and who is who in the TikTok extended universe.
There'll be interviews with content creators we follow, fellow journalists who have reported brilliantly on the app, and much more.
As fellow millennials, we understand how overwhelming it can be to try to keep up with who's dating who, what dance is trending, or who's getting canceled.
So we've created this podcast to try to keep you and us up to speed.
You don't want to miss it. Subscribe to us on Apple, Spotify, and anywhere else you get your podcast fix.
And please, don't let this flop.
We're joking, but also not really.